Good morning and welcome to our webcast. This is session number 94. I am your moderator, Samir Mehta. And we are going to take you to the cardiac catheterization for a most unusual case today. We have an elderly patient with a previous bypass surgery who's also had a placement of a CoreValve TAVR, and we are going to show you a complex PCI of a calcified protected left main performed through the struts of the CoreValve. And the last I checked with Dr. Kini and Dr. Dangus in the cath lab, they were having struggles getting in a guiding catheter. I'm sure you'll find this case extremely instructive. It's not something which most operators are going to find commonly, but this is also something which is going to be coming our way soon. Anu, Samin, good morning, and I guess keeping with the complexity of the case, we need three operators today.
Yeah, that's what I was going to tell. We needed
Sharma joined, so things will turn the positive way now.
Yeah. George, good morning, and delighted to have you there, and we keep enjoying you with the structural cases.
Yes. Anu, and of course.
Samin, can I also congratulate Anu on a wonderful award she get, and will you tell us about it?
Oh, yeah, that is the Ellis Island Medal of Honor. That is the immigrants who have come to America and have made it, achieved significant in their profession, whatever the profession is, and more importantly, then you become citizen. So in order to get the award, you need to be a citizen of United States. So this is Ellis Island. So now in our cardiology, Dr. Fuster, myself, and of course, Dr. Kini now joining, this is a great honor.
Congratulations, Kini, from me, as well as I think from many, many viewers around the world.
Yes, and it's a really very respectable award. The other big thing with this award is,
I think sinus. We went here
it's actually a great ceremony. The name, those who are awardees, which are about 80 to 90 per year, they go to the Congressional Register. So it has a lot of prestige with the award. And I know that Dr. Kini got a big publicity. While the award will be done on May 13th, the numerous newspapers have covered the announcement. And from our Indians' point of view, there are a few CEOs, including Nuri from Pepsi Cola. So clearly, a lot of the advanced people will be getting this award on May 13th.
Just wonderful, Anu. Well earned, and congratulations. Samin, what are you going to discuss? And although the focus today has to be on this extremely difficult case.
Yes. Yeah, well, this is a. The key is that these are the challenges which we encounter when the new device and techniques come. And that's where we are right now at present. Yeah, so we actually, engaging the guide catheter through the core wall struts. As we showed that in the December when the ACC the recommendation came out that these patients, if have significant lesion, irrespective of their medical therapy or stress test, should undergo PCI if appropriate. And clearly that is no, you don't do a stress test, you cannot do FFR in these patients, and so on and so forth. So the challenge always remains. Clearly it's less challenging in the Sapien valve because the valve is more infracoronary and much more challenging for the core valve, and this is what the case of today will be. We had done maybe about a 2+ dozen PCIs through the core valve at present, because our center is the big in the core valve, these patients now keep coming back with the future events, even if you are taken care at the time zero. In the past, actually, we used to leave many of these lesions alone, and we learned that that was a troublesome, because those patients then survive. Particularly, you go to a high risk and intermediate risk, they come back with a coronary event. So clearly the focus has been that if you have a significant lesion and patient survival you think is more than 2 years and so with the TAVR, so it's probably better off do the intervention before the TAVR. So you wait for about 30-40 days and then do the TAVR. So PCI, cath PCI and then followed by a staged TAVR.
That's a very, very practical recommendation. George, how do you approach these cases? Just the diagnostic angiography?
Angiography actually is easy. You can do sinus angiograms, but I think if you are to do PCI, you see the struggle we have gone through.
George,
but you will see that the well, for the CoreValve particularly, the trick is that you have to approach it from the top. Usual way we engage a left corner is you go to the bottom of the valve and then you let the extra backup guides deflect upwards. Here you cannot do that. You have to use preferably FL or a short VL guide and approach from the top. As you see live, that was done right now. This is a highly unusual guide, FL3 we have right now.
Okay, so if we can show the slide quickly, and then we come to this picture. These are our supporters. These are our disclosure with the George Dangus added on. And this is the 81-year-old male who had prior bypass surgery and had a TAVR in January 2015. So at that time, he actually had a Lima to LAD, which is fine, and then also has a vein graft to the RCA. Those were fine. Then graft, which is goes to OM to diagonal, was occluded proximally, but jump segment was patent. So he had a known 80-90% distal left main and ostial circ disease. But at that time felt, because he has two good grafts that do medical therapy on those lesions and do the TAVR. So patient got the TAVR, 29 millimeter core valve in January 2015. Just to say that we are learning more and more. And of course, patient has been now did good from the valve point of view, but having classical angina despite medical therapy as shown here. Next. And this is the angiogram. Next slide. So this is now we are going to show. So basically multiple disease, which I mentioned, now Dr. Anu will show that what we have in terms of this practical while taking the pictures. And then I'll come back to our presentation.
Samin, is there some AI?
We'll show you. So this is the VL3 guide, which normally we would have used in this kind of situation. But if you see here, VL3 definitely, way it's facing down, we know it's a larger guide. So then we change it to this is the FL. But it was same, we were in the wrong sinus, we were in the right sinus, not in the left sinus. And then we are showing you VL3 again, we were able to get in the left sinus. I think the key here is that we have to be at the right diamond. The problem here is what has happened, the whole valve with the diamond sitting in the annulus, we are not able to engage, go into the right diamond to get into the coronary. We are just showing you how this was engaged. This is the fluoro. See that?
And Anu, you tried getting the guide wire across and trying to bring the guide. That didn't work either?
That one did not, because we were not engaged in the coronary. I think this is where we are just showing you how we got the guide into one of the diamond, but then it is just in the sinus, not in the left main. It looked like we are close.
Samin, you want to start your discussion as we...
A little bit of AI, as you mentioned, is not
uncommon. No, I think we were just at the leaflet. See there?
Yeah.
The guide sitting at the on the leaflet.
Okay. So now, then we use a which catheter?
We tried with Akari, did not work. FL. Now we have the FL.
That looks
And we are ready to take a picture now.
The closest
Good.
This is elective now.
Now we got the tell. It's a 6 French. Mark FL3. 1 FL3O of Let's Boston see. Scientific. Yeah, take a picture.
You can see the very good projection. You see it sticking out.
Yeah. Ready?
Yeah, go.
That should be good enough, George.
No need. Let's engage first. Do you want to go with supercross now?
Go to the aortocaudal first, because that's where you're going to see.
Let's have to get into the left main. It looks like we're not in the aortocaudal.
But ischemia, in this case, is all in the circumflex territory.
Yeah. See here.
Yeah, you like can't make out much in this view.
Yeah.
I know. That will always will be the problem.
Cannot see. It's across. Ready?
Yeah. Yeah. So you know what? 1 second. Go to. If you do just the AP, because clearly, yeah, good. I think this will be the good one. Okay. You want to give a little nitro or no?
Yeah, I all don't th- nitro.
Huh? No. So the, maybe open up a little bit. Keep holding.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is
all
it.
All right.
Yeah.
Very good.
Get the super cross. If we get in.
That's a good roadmap of the challenge you have today.
Okay. Yes.
4 plus calcification, critical distal left main, angulated origin of the circumflex, and
without a guide.
No, you got the good guide now.
No.
Reasonable guide.
FL never gives any support.
Yeah. Yeah. But let's try.
Okay.
Yep.
Super plus 90 you have?
Well, one aspect of the guide is that sometimes because this guide is sticking out of the struts of the valve, maybe stuck a little bit, and the struts add on to the support of the guide. We're about to find out.
All right. So the struts are providing the support here.
In some
we'll
ways,
we'll
it's difficult to get in, but yeah, once you get in, maybe it will come out easily.
My fear is as soon as the wire strikes the lesion, the guide will be pulled
out.
Samin.
Yeah. So with that note, I just want to continue. So that's our goal today. Let's go back to the slides.
Advance.
Yeah. Can we take this thing out here? I don't know why this is wireless, Wi-Fi coming. This guy just paid the attention. Yeah, but you have to turn it off. Yeah, we are going to go through the struts as we have shown. Use the guideliner as well as rotational atherectomy because you saw it. A very calcific lesion. Now, this is the latest one we have used now. Oct 2017, I told you last week that we are going to change our the way we present.
Did you flush?
It basically is the Lima to LED, which is patent without stenosis. So in this particular case, patient has intermediate to high risk stress test and has more than two drugs. So from PCI point of view, it's appropriate. So intervention is truly appropriate. So before we go on, I have an angiogram of the pre-TAVR, and I wanted to just show that how it is. So let's see if we can, I'm going to try because I think this was a very important while we're trying to get into the wiring that we understand clearly that how big is the ischemia because there is a circumflex which is a good size.
Meanwhile, we're assembling the system here, which is the filter wire, the Supercross 90 inside a guideliner. And we're going to go with this system and block up towards the ostium of the left main.
All right.
Three-piece system.
Okay.
This is the angiogram?
Yeah, this is the angiogram in January of 2015.
Before the tower.
Before the tower?
Right.
Guys, you have to help me out.
I have
no idea what that is. No, but it's coming.
It's a large circumflex.
Yeah, it's a large circumflex. See that? And then this is the comparative flow between the diagonal. What happened is the jump segment from the diagonal to this OM. See comparative flow? But it's not enough. So large, very calcific. Now it has become subtotal.
Right.
And the distal left main, as you can see here.
Tremendous progression of disease in 15
That's
months, no?
Exactly. Tremendous. So this is the one aortic, as you can see here. Then the right coronary. There is a graft to the right, which we haven't taken any pictures today because of high creatinine. And we are just going by that, knowing that patient does not have any ischemia in the inferior wall. We expect is fine. And then the Lima. Lima supplies the LAD. Yeah, will
excellent,
better picture.
Excellent,
yes.
Lima, yeah.
Yes. Sorry, I think,
Yeah, this picture maybe. Yeah, no. The we non-selective injection.
Yeah,
actually,
but,
no, I think
but
we did
it
a
looks
yeah. Yeah. No, I thought we did a better picture. Sorry. We did a better picture of the lima, yeah. And there's no ischemia in the anterior wall. So again, right. Just to
that's
save the dye,
lovely picture
look
of
at
the
this.
Lima.
Very yeah. Significant. Now, this is that the graft. So I mean the diagonal, which is the jump from the proximal anastomosis of the graft to the D1 to OM1 is completely occluded. But you can see that from the lima, some flow occurs. See that? This is the diagonal jump. From D1 to OM1.
Right. Yeah.
Right there. So that's where we are. So very disease circumflex and the distal left main. But that's, and now try to get the support in this particular case. I mean, that's basically is the whole major issue at this time. So now we actually, I don't know, I need to ask someone that this internet thinks. I'm sorry, what? Yeah. Yes.
And that's with the super cross there. Is that?
That's the super cross.
And the,
yes,
the guideliner.
The guide wire in the LAD and the yeah. Super cross is in the left main. And we're trying to get the guideliner in the proximal left main.
No.
No. You got to make sure the guide sticks out again and then push it to the guide.
Okay.
The guy was sticking out before. Yeah, yeah, good. Let's see now if there is a guy that goes.
You've been able to seat the guide much better now.
Other thing is, we have to change the wire to like a grand slam.
No, you're there. Let's see, does it make the turn?
No.
No, we need a balloon support maybe to make the turn. Inflate the balloon, the left main to suck in the guideline.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Yeah.
So.
All right, some progress has been made. Yeah.
Not good. Okay, get us, now only thing is how will we take this one out?
It's always very difficult.
You think 300 run through will go?
Yeah, 300 run through.
What question you need miracle, no?
No, not that. We are thinking we have to get the guideliner in. For that, we need a balloon. We have to go open the left main.
First, okay.
Without left main, nothing is happening.
No, but let's change the wire.
See that? That's all I can get left guideliner.
Okay.
Guideliner is right at the left main, but just doesn't make the turn.
Yeah.
But that's okay. So now let's take
what?
The wire out and we try to put a
300 run through.
Yeah.
And then,
take
we have to take this out.
We try to take
and,
a 2.5 balloon or something.
Yeah, and then suck the guideliner in.
Okay.
Yeah.
And we hope it stays
20 balloon or something.
Yeah. No, first
two five,
do a little compliant
balloon.
First. I would go with a 2.5.
2.5, 20, something, 15, whatever
15.
You like.
And then try to get the wire into the circ.
Yeah, later on.
Yeah, later on. Yeah.
Excellent.
Right. You know, the first goal is to get the guideliner in the left main. So you have something that's through the, that is through the valve.
George, how many of these have you done?
One.
Okay.
Again, a circumflex, I have to say.
Right.
Again, a circumflex.
No, I had done quite a bit of
right. You
LED,
mentioned you have done
the
about
left
20
circumflex.
In the hospital.
Actually, one patient I had done five times.
Right.
He has the bypass. Yeah. He keeps coming back with a circ or ramus restenosis.
Some dye here? Oh, cannot. You think it's going into the circ?
No.
No.
But let's say advance, if you can go.
It's not, they're not going.
Yeah. I think this, the cross it, I mean super cross didn't help.
It is helping, it's going
well,
into
it's helping,
circle.
Just that we need something in the left main. How come it doesn't go in the LAD now?
Very sharply
chain.
Angulated.
If we think it's going to the circ, probably at the circ.
Yeah, it could be.
But
what
I.
Do you want to use your miracle six here? Before we. Huh?
Yeah, but okay. Get us a miracle six.
And you can see the calcium shadow. It's actually the vessel is outside, the lumen is outside.
Yeah.
Okay, get us miracle six. If we get the wire down there, right? What happened is it's angulated, no?
Yeah, very sharply angulated.
No,
though.
The super cross is angulated catheter. That's why probably
it's directing it. Yeah.
Yeah, directing it into
put
a different.
Back inside,
let's see.
Yeah.
So you want to go back on the super cross now?
No, it is facing. Yeah. Looks like we can get into the circ. Let's see.
Let's give it a shot.
Yeah. If not, we have to go back to our original plan.
George, in such a patient, if you needed some support, LV support, what would you use?
LV support is doable for
no, and not in this case. I mean, this
no,
is
no, in
yeah.
general, you can
no
put
issue
LV support even in Pella through those valves.
Although we have not done any case of like
with
that,
the
but it can be done. It's been, you know, you just have to make sure you enter with a pigtail and
right.
you verify that you are not through any of the struts. You have to use a 6-inch pigtail to enter, make sure it doesn't go through in and out of the struts, and then it should be really fine. You can see that the wire seems to be crossing there. What I wanted to tell you about the other case was again a circumflex. I was lucky that as the guide came in trying to manipulate
okay,
the balloons, the guide was sucked into the left main
yes.
And was stayed there for duration, providing good support and everything. And unfortunately, here we can't make the guide make that turn.
Let's see the
George, is there a concern? You have to be relatively careful. Is there a potential for any damage to any of the struts with the two aggressive maneuvers of the guiding catheter?
No, not really.
No.
And
no,
does
no.
it matter? Should they all be 6-French or you can use a bigger guide if need be?
I think you have a trouble advancing a 6-French. A bigger guide is not going to go through.
Right.
And everything has to do with the direction of the left main takeoff.
No, it's going easy.
You see here the difficulty is that we had the guide to come through the strut. So the left main is a little off plane. It's not exactly in the regular plane, just a little bit to the side. And it's probably taking off in front of a wire itself. So one, if you are on one diamond, you're a little bit tangential. If you're the other one, you're a little bit too high. And if you're in the third one, you're a little bit too low. So far, though, so good. It looks like the wire is somewhere, and we try to get the guideline in the left main. You get a chance to see a little bit more.
I think what we need to do now.
Then I would say take this out, go with a fine cross, and try to go to the LED. We cross a little bit, and then do a rotor 1.25 bar.
In the LED.
Yeah. Left main to LED right now.
Let's see.
I think the
we
key is that you had to open the left main to LED.
Well, yeah. It's
no,
the
but
same
can
black.
You do a connection here? No, right?
Yeah,
you can.
Yeah. Dark. You
get us a dark.
Mm-hmm.
I think we'll be okay. We dark. We take it out. Take this out. We go with the 2.5 balloon.
For
2.5
balloon,
and
try
it
to
in.
Suck the guideline already.
Yeah. So we just still go with the same.
You want to get a 1.25 balloon? 2.5.
Yeah, yeah. 1.25 in the left.
Yeah.
Wing.
Give us a 1.25.
But
balloon.
It will not suck the.
Yeah, but whatever. Right now.
Well, let's try that one first. If not, then you try the other one. The advantage here that we have to take a little bit is that this left main is about 15 millimeter long. So if we're able to take advantage of that, it's not diseased, you can park a guideliner there, we can launch our wires and the equipment better. So that's a clear advantage of this case. A disadvantage is the left main comes a little bit in an unusual takeoff. You can see comes a little higher
than the sinus.
And
straight.
All the guides were actually aiming well
more
underneath the
yeah.
current left main. So it hadn't been exactly at the sinus, it would be getting in easier.
So we did got a dark wire and we took out the the super cross out.
Balloon.
Now we will go with 1.25 balloon.
1.25 or
1.25?
Okay.
Oh yeah. 1.25 to the distal left main. You see the distal left main is heavily calcified. So we'll place a 1.25 balloon there, dilate it and see if the guideliner can be sucked in over the balloon. You have a 2 already, 2 or 12 to get in.
Yeah,
okay, 2515.
So, I mean, all these valve related, have you used, you had mentioned almost all of them were core valves or any sapiens also?
No, we had done sapien. Yeah.
You've done it also.
Actually, our third case was sapien.
For the PCI.
PCI. Yeah. But difficulty is in with the core valve.
Right. As we can see now.
Yeah. Difficulty is the core valve.
Because the point is the sapien is the all the
sapien behaves like a SAVR, like any surgical valve.
Yeah, sapien will give you more trouble acutely because of the height and may occlude. And that's why the data have been the coronary occlusion more higher with the sapien. But subsequent angiography is much easier with sapien compared to the core valve.
Particularly sapien 3, the tallest, the highest strut is very big, much bigger than the other struts, exactly for this reason. It's much wider. Balloon doesn't go in now?
This is 1.25.
Okay, it is in through and through.
Through the strut a little bit.
We could use a glider also.
Okay. Ready?
Go.
I think it's across the
Yeah, the guideliner hasn't
balloon is
moved
right
too
at the ostium of the left main.
Right.
We went in, came into the guide. See there?
Yep. Okay. I'm going up here.
Okay.
No. It's not going to help here.
Okay, then you have to go with the fine cross into the LED.
Yeah.
But that's what I was thinking. We may never be able to get into the circ then.
No?
That later, but let's do at least open the left main first.
Right.
Oh, we don't even have the guide.
Huh?
Not even have the guide.
No, but you mean any other guide?
No, guide into the.
Yeah. No, you will not get better guide support than what we have at present.
Some die? Are we in the left main? Then let me try to get the guideliner. Yeah.
Still there.
As soon as I get the guideliner, everything comes out. Okay, get the fine cross and let's get into the, right?
Yeah, I think this will be removed.
Anu, what was the first wire which you had used for the LED?
Fielder,
okay. You don't want to go back with the same one?
No, that's what we're going to do now.
Right.
Fielder and go fine cross. But the question is the distal left main is so tight, the super cross would not go there. But now even the balloon is not going there.
Yeah, but once I think you have the wire very distally in the LED, you might be able to suck in the guide a little more, but we'll see.
But you had a wire earlier distally, right?
Yes, in the distal left main.
In the apical LED.
The wire went all the way to the apical LED.
Then if we can change with the rotor wire and put a 1.25. So while we are doing it, let's go back to our...
Give me the fielder again. Fielder?
The question is, you want to rotate the strut, no, of
you
the, will
the
you rotate the strut of the, of the, of the core valve? That's a thought.
Yep.
Cut it.
That's a thought. Yep. I mean, you know.
No, but what? This one.
Which
it
one?
May not go.
No, the main thing is we want the guideliner in the left main.
Okay.
That's the goal now.
because we don't know. Okay, oh, you mean it will not go? It will.
That's fine. But there's not side room anyway.
Mm.
It will go.
Absolutely okay. Fascinating case to show.
Yes.
This is, I'm sure as our experience increases, we'll learn so many tricks, particularly which guide to use and.
Advances wire is fine. But you remember this has to go in first.
Yeah, going in the side first.
Yeah, now, 1 second. Yeah, no.
Garbage, everything is super.
Was the side?
Okay, side by side. The fielder went in the side.
Yes.
Okay, go. Now the fielder is probably destroyed. Is it or no?
Yeah.
It's okay. Another drawback of
my question
guideliner.
Is that put a guideliner right now?
Go. That's this case will not be done without guideliner.
Okay.
If you cannot have guideliner, then this guide is not even giving us any support.
The rota through the guideliner.
Yeah, that's true. No, but 1.25 I think will be okay.
1.25 maybe goes.
Go SS wire.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Hold on. Pull back. Okay, go now. Go. Yes?
Yep.
George, bivalirudin being used here?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
This is the default anticoagulant. High ACT. This is why, particularly in this case, with all these many exchanges in and out, you cannot let the ACT drift down with the heparin and all that. You may have a thrombosis.
Right. So now the same challenge.
So many guides and equipment inside, and so many equipment in the guide. And
now I think the guide is out.
No,
now.
Guide is out.
Yeah, completely.
You're above.
There you go. There looks to be.
You may still be above.
Yeah.
Above.
Other question, do you want an EBU guide? If we're going that way. EBU will be a little more steady.
We'll have EBU 3 guide in the back.
Because FL3 is good.
This okay, is looks a little different there. No? Yes.
Okay, whatever.
Yeah, you can see, Samir, exactly this. The guide naturally goes into that strut, but the left main is not from the sinus. It's a little higher, and that creates a particular problem.
Higher even, I thought, George, in one of the earlier views, slightly almost angulated also in.
Yes, exactly.
So
it's a little angulated. That's why also the guideliner, et cetera, cannot make it in.
Yeah.
Nothing is smaller
than
VL3. No, EBU.
That's the smallest EBU that we have, EBU3, we're going into try now.
George, has much been published on techniques for approaching these cases?
Sent something to CCI.
Fascinating case, absolutely.
Describing how these cases should be done.
Yeah.
One second before you go in. Go.
Get us a new FL3.
We wish to have an EBU 2.75.
Right, yeah, even this looks a little big.
Cut it a little bit.
Look for Akari 1.5 also.
What did we use? Akari has no support.
You Akari left, you use or? No. Akari right, 1.5. Yeah, good.
Ah.
There we go.
That's a little better. Okay.
Let
them work on it. So we go our
the points. Meanwhile, we get to our slideshow again.
I think basically,
what I'm going to talk about the 2 points.
About the guideliner?
Right now, I think without guideliner, yeah. Without guideliner.
Why both?
And one is the MACE trial, right? 1 year outcome which we presented. No, without guideliner, let's try to cross and maybe we can use a 1.25 bar for the rota. That's one thing, yeah. Because guideliner may not go through the rota may not go through the guideliner.
Okay.
Yeah, so, and clearly the George I have here with
back.
Us, particularly making comment on the Absorb 3 trial, because a lot of controversy and particularly the Absorb BVS, the FDA warning, and he just has the rapid publication in the JACC about a meta-analysis. So basically, first is the MACE trial. MACE basically was the trial to see, we know that calcium had been bad by various studies, but the impact of calcification on PCI prospective result. So what is the MACE system? We knew that degree of calcium, which is the red, the moderate, severe calcium, moderate being the brown, and blue being none to mild. Even various trials, including the acute coronary syndrome trial, have shown bad outcome once you go to the calcific lesion. So therefore, this trial, MACE, stands for multi-center prospective study to evaluate acute outcomes, evaluate outcomes of none, mild, moderate, and severely calcified coronary lesions, MACE study. It's a study of 350 subjects enrolled in 33 sites, and angiography core lab was with Jeffrey Popma, and basically they assigned the calcium not based on the investigator, but from the core lab. And basically, the 350 cases, this was not a randomization. It was decided based on the site. So what technique, whatever you need to use, but classify the lesion. So before we got into the study of this 33 sites, I'm being the PI, we asked the investigators to send 10 films, grading them, none, mild, moderate, or severe calcium. And actually, it's very interesting. And of course, then we have a 1 year follow up. The key of these patients, as you can see here, 133 in the first group, 99 in the second, and 114 in the severe calcium. And up to 1 year follow up is the data which I'm going to show. More importantly, that investigator for the severe calcium, and this is question always comes, do you do IVUS for calcium? And so severe calcium, the 97% reproducibility. So investigator felt severe calcium, core lab felt severe calcium in 97% of the time. So I think we do a very good job in terms of identifying the severe calcium, and the data of the individual group I'm going to show you. Basically, once you go to a severe calcium, these are the more older patients, and you can see here the lower BMI and higher GFR. The rest of the risk factors were about same, except the higher, known CAD. Once you have more known CAD, they're usually more calcific lesions. As far as the vessels are concerned, that LED, more severe calcium in the LED, whether it's a selection bias or so, and less calcium in the circumflex. 1.25 right now.
Oh, this thing went.
Okay, then 1.5. Good. Then 1.5.
So
this is the target lesion baseline characteristics, and very interesting. And this is in this day and age, as you can see, that in this day and age, in the severe calcium in the United States, 1 year ago, the atherectomy was used in 32.5% of cases only. So even severe calcified lesions in United States at present are done 1/3 with the rotational or very few with the laser, and orbital atherectomy was not allowed. Although two patients got the orbital atherectomy, that was the protocol deviation. But because this trial started before the OA was approved. So clearly this, just to say, 1/3 of the patient with the severely calcified got the atherectomy, and 21% in the moderate. Now, George, were you not surprised that even severely calcific in this day and age in United States, only 33% are getting the atherectomy? Rest are still being tried with the non.
I'm very surprised, and indeed, this probably either some focal lesions or an attempt to do the multiple angiosculpt or cutting balloon initially, and then try with sequential high pressure balloon and all that. Obviously, you use a lot of equipment and use a lot of time in the patient's coronary to try to break up severe calcification if you don't use atherectomy.
Yeah, and actually also surprising, your cutting balloon angioscalp, all they put into the cutting balloon category was used just in about 10% of cases. But anyway, these are our outcomes. And then of course, the results that clearly severely calcific lesion, you have more procedure time, more fluoroscopy time, and higher contrast volume, as you can see here. Although the target lesion, the final MLD was identical in three groups. Now, overall procedural success and the lesion success basically showed the gradient that once you have a severe calcified, you have a lower procedural success as shown here. And largely, this is driven by that in-hospital MACE. So basically, you are able to get your stent delivered, but you have higher in-procedural in-hospital MACE in the severely calcific vessels, and this is what the type of MACE was, the myocardial infarction, because it was defined as more than three times, that more than three times of the CKMB release. But other, whether it's the cardiac death and TVR was not different, and so. So if you take a definition of the SCAI, the more than 10 times, it's only 2.6% in the severe calcified. Now, the lesion success was successful stent delivery, and post dilatation less than 50%, and no angiographic calcification. Again, was lower in the severely calcified group, and it was again driven by the dissection. You see here, perforation, coronary abrupt closure, or slow flow was identical between three groups. So only it's the dissection, that severely calcific lesion had a higher angiographic dissection. Now this is the 1 year outcome. Basically, clearly, that is the severely calcific lesion has a bad outcome compared to mild or moderate. So one thing we learned, that overall, that gradient is more so between mild, moderate to severe. So key is that our focus has to be on the severely calcific lesion. They have higher MI at 1 year and higher target vessel revascularization, no difference in depth. So therefore, now what we don't have answer yet, and they are being analyzing, that 33% of cases in the severe calcium of this 100 plus cases, was the, when who had the rotational atherectomy, was there a different outcome? So that will be something to know, that by changing the lesion by atherectomy, do you change the outcome? So we'll have, once manuscript is ready, we'll have that part. So to really put this atherectomy concept, plaque modification concept to the task, is the Eclipse trial, which just started. And this is the first of its kind of 2,000 patients with orbital atherectomy versus just your PTCA followed by the lesion preparation and then the stent deployment and of course optimization. So this is the event-driven trial with a 1 year, the one of the major endpoint being a 1 year target vessel failure and post PCI instant in the 400 patients. So key is the first time the clinical-driven trial of atherectomy has started using orbital atherectomy. And of course, in the orbital group, they said after orbit, you do only PTCA, while in the conventional angioplasty group, you can use the cutting balloon and angiosculp, but no rotational atherectomy. And I understand the reason behind it, but clearly the whole idea is that whether orbital atherectomy makes the difference on long run need to be seen. The second, very quickly, because Anu is ready now, the ABSORB 3 trial, the 2 year outcome just came. The concept of absorbable stent without causing inflammation was very good, very theoretical. Everything looks good until we have in the TCT, they presented the data of 3 year of the ABSORB 2 with a scaffold thrombosis of 3% versus 0 in the Zions. And all very important that all those occurred, patients who were on single antiplatelet therapy. So clearly it seems to be that once you're talking about the ABSORB, you need to give a dual antiplatelet therapy for the long period of time. And these were the individual data of now the ABSORB 2 with a 3 year endpoint, which was published, and we had discussed in our here that all the events were higher, as you can see, in the ABSORB group compared to the Zions group. More importantly, and I think this is what coming up. So rather than getting the ABSORB only resolved, which is the ideal, the scaffold resorption, what happens is that scaffold discontinuity occurs. So once you start absorbing, in the past we thought that it's going to dissolve slowly. But it seems to be that if it is not opposed in the wall, and this is the most crucial point, which is the left lower slide, that unless your absorb is in the vessel wall, it's hanging and unopposed. Once you start getting dissolution, It caused the fragments into the vessel, and that caused the thrombosis. And that's caused the all problem, in my opinion, is that whether your absorbed stent is in the lumen or is in the vessel wall. So this is the whole outcome, and all the technique of the absorb are dependent on push the absorbed stent in the vessel wall, and it should not be in the lesion. It should not be in the lumen. George, what do you say about mechanistic, besides having a...
There is no question that what we see with the clinical data falls short of the expectations of this golden ring that is stabilized after a few years and the perfect absorption kinetics and all that that were shown by imaging and by the animal models. And it seems like in the human disease coronary arteries, with a lot of fibrotic plaque and all that, unstable plaques, maybe if you do not achieve good apposition, or the plaques are still active and create malapposition, then you're left with the absorbed scaffold also being disrupted by the absorption process that is non-uniform, and you can have essentially smooshed and crumbled, cracking fragments there, either flying distally or creating inside to thrombosis right then and there. So there is a vulnerable period. And also now they tell us that if the stent, if the scaffold struts are not in the contact with the vessel wall, then those struts not absorbed fast or not at all, because the absorption kinetics are figured out only in the animal models part where the scaffold struts were flush at the vessel wall. In essence, the vessel wall absorbs the strut. If it's not in contact, it's not going to absorb it.
Very, very important point. And that's where the whole concept, which we emphasized back in December also, the concept of PSP, prepare the lesion, size appropriately, and post-dilate. So that's the minimum you need once you're using a BVS. Now you say, well, have you shown? Yes. The data of the two center showing that early experience versus BVS specific protocol, which is same pre-dilatation, appropriate size, post-dilatation, PSP, decrease the thrombosis from 3% to 1%, which I would say similar to our metal DES. So that makes sense of this. I can tell you data, our center, 51 cases. We have 48 with the OCT, all with the PSP. We did not have any stent thrombosis. There has been some TLR and TVR, particularly at the edges, but basically overall no issue of stent thrombosis at Sinai so far. So basically, quickly, that Absorb 3, two-year data was just presented by Alice in ACC, and what they did is they divided the 1 year and the 1 year and 2 year, but more importantly, all as well as the small vessel, and that is important because that's where goes the FDA warning. Second, as you can see, 1/3 of the patient at 2 years were off the DAPT, taking only single antiplatelet therapy, and so basically what we saw overall on the left side and the reference vessel more than 2.25. QCA, which is angiography more than 2.5, on the right side. So overall, the height of the absorb, which is the yellow, compared to the blue, which is the Zions, that all event rates were much higher in the absorb group compared to the Zions group. And particularly when you go to the vessel size of more than 2.25, the difference becomes less. But still, there is a thrombosis rate almost double, 0.7 to 1.5, 0.6 to 0.9. So 1.5 to 2 times higher scaffold thrombosis, even in the larger vessel, and so. Of course, at 1 year and 3 year data, which are shown here. So then there is another trial which was just published, ADA investigator from Denmark of the bioabsorbable, showing basically again same. No difference in overall the MACE event except the device thrombosis, again 0.9 versus 3.5. So clearly, that scaffold thrombosis remains a major issue, and this is what the authors actually mentioned, that while overall event rate doesn't change, but target vessel failure, but it's the stent thrombosis. Now this is George, the rapid publication in the JACC. We have seven randomized, the meta-analysis of the seven randomized trial, where looked into the target vessel failure as well as stent thrombosis. George, you want to comment on this?
Yes, definitely. Including, we analyzed all the studies to date, including this last AIDA that was published just 2 weeks ago. And we documented that the both target vessel failure, the efficacy was lower, as well as the stent thrombosis, the safety, was also unfavorable. And obviously the study is not very clear which patients are subjected to PSP. I can tell you in trying to analyze by the time, assuming that the PSP was used in the later part, that also did not pan out very, very favorable. So we'll have to wait on other studies on that. And one comment is that if you look at the PSP recommendations Dr. Sharma presented, it's nothing really too complicated. Mm-hmm. You have to size it appropriately, you have to know what you're doing, you have to post-dilate. So the question is, why wasn't those followed from the beginning? Because this is essentially, you go back to 1996, standing 101, those are included. And the answer is, initially, everybody was obsessed about maybe scaffold be broken with a post-dilation. And everybody was crazy to avoid touching it, and you touch it, this and that, and don't worry, this is a magic device that's gonna go in, it's gonna go away, you're gonna have a beautiful ring. But obviously, you know, that was a fairy tale that didn't really pan out that way in real life. And now we're back to essentially coronary stenting technique 101 with the imaging, the sizing, and the post-dilation, and obviously more of the problems were found in the small vessels. No, again, no no surprises there as well. We know that from coronary stenting 102.
That is true. So Absorb 4, I would say, will be the deal breaker, whether the device going to continue or will be pulled off. That's what I think. This is the trial ongoing at present, one-to-one Absorb versus Zion's 3,000 patient. And basically, primary endpoint is the angina relief, because that we think one of the important points. But more importantly, this is they have done the interim data presented in ACC also. And that is, if you take the Absorb 3 and Absorb 4 pooled, although not cases yet, they have not been unblinded. But overall, post dilatation of PSP, we are doing it almost in 85%+ of cases now, which used to be 66% before. Second, that basically smaller vessels are being used less because of the understanding what we have learned, and therefore overall thrombosis rate as in unblinded group is only 0.5%. So even if you put all of them in the Absorb group and Zion 0, you can think that clearly it will be a lower scaffold thrombosis at 1 year than any report so far, right? I mean, it gives you the idea, although we don't have the breakdown, and this leads to that small versus large vessel. And this actually was the FDA warning, basically the major adverse event, and that was letter sent to all the healthcare providers based on the data of the Absorb 2 and 2 year data, that avoid this in a small vessel. Very simple message, avoid a small vessel and do preparation. So if you are doing an Absorb, you have to put extra time and so forth. And this actually leads to overall the use now, as you know, that recent announcement by the Abbott in the out of United States, that Absorb can only be sold based on the registry. So cannot be, so every case which will Absorb being implanted will be part of the registry. I don't think this has been fully executed in United States. The Absorb 4 trial is still ongoing. But idea there is that really track it and use it in the large vessel. And I know right now it has a kind of questionable name, but at the same time you do a good lesion preparation and post dilatation, it's a good device in selected group of patients. And I'll ask Annu to make a final comment before he's ready to do a rotational atherectomy on this tough case, which is not an Absorb case anyway. Yeah.
Thank God for that, that we don't we have to place the Absorb through them.
We wish some of these struts were absorbed up there.
Let some Absorb in there. I mean, the concept-wise was excellent. I think concept started way back when the DES first generation came out, and there was a stent thrombosis happening at 1 year and 2 year time. The concept was why not we have something that will be absorbed. But finally when it came to testing, was tested against third and fourth generation top of the range DES, which people are used to, is no preparation. They either pre, post, or nothing, just place the stent, no matter 38 millimeter and longer stents go anywhere and every part of the vessel. So when Absorb came, one, the device was bulkier, was difficult to deliver, and same, the initial scare was you just place it and come out, you should not post dilate it. And this is what we saw subsequently, that when we were in the trial also, though calcific lesions were not involved, if there was even mild calcium, the device was difficult to deliver. And as we were doing the case, we realized that unless you post dilate, there's no way this stent would get one-to-one vessel size. And since it was not metal, most of it was the plastic. Even we did post-dilation, it would not, the vessel would still, we would not see the full expansion of the so-called
some stent. Recoil.
Yeah, recoil always was there. And that is what I think we are seeing now in your clinical outcome. But I think like Dr. Sharma mentioned, we should be careful, should not be using it, I would say, anything about 2.7 and lower. Larger vessel, proximal vessel, which is probably proximal LAD, proximal RCA, proximal circ, where you know it is 3.0, 3.5, that's the place where you need to use it, and you know, post-dilate it, make sure it is fully opposed, and if imaging is there, you know, try to use imaging until you know that you are comfortable to do it.
And we all agree that we've got to use DAPT or long time.
Yeah, that's a DAPT.
Until further notice.
Yeah, and that is
1 year for definite, but should we go for 3 years?
With the absorb, based on the data, I would say
3 years.
Yeah, now George, the last word from you, absorb 4. What is your prediction? What do you think, will the absorb BVS likely to come back if the absorb 4 with a good post dilatation is reasonable?
I think they will have a better fourth quarter, but you know, I don't know it's going to be enough to topple the entire game.
Yes. Okay. All right. So with that note.
Yeah, excellent review. There are a few follow-up questions and comments, but Anu, first bring us up to speed. This is a
Everybody,
a big challenge here.
We got lost in the absorb.
Lost
now
in
let's come back to
there,
the
huh?
this yeah. case where we are now. We changed the guide, which was a EBU 3.0 guide, which is sitting fairly well. Then we went with our initial plan. We took the fine cross and went with the fielder. Fine cross, we were able to, you know, navigate through the, you know, the tight left main, same, you know, corkscrew movement of the fine cross, we were able to navigate all the way down, you see it, and then we exchange the fielder wire to, we have rota extra support wire, because we know the guide is not in the left main, we will have to do rota with the guide sitting just at the ostium of the left main, so we took a rota extra support knowing that we will have difficulty in getting the rota across there. But since the fine cross the lesion, we changed to one fiber. So what our plan would be that once we open the distal left main, hopefully we will get the guideliner into the left main, and then and we have opened the left main to LAD,
the
then we'll try to get into the circ. Okay.
But at the same time, I would say, remember I showed you the angiogram. There is a jump segment from the diagonal to the OM. So even if you can open the left main and with the knowing the with the high creatinine and you put one stent and do nothing more on this patient will be reasonable approach.
Right. Okay.
The just left main to LAD indirectly because circ is very difficult. You'll be creating dissection, requiring multiple stent, maybe even tough. If we can get a good blood flow from the diagonal going into that OM, because that jump segment is still fine.
Right.
Will be a middle approach. Go. Let's
middle
go.
Approach?
Yeah. Well, let's today we are talking about the middle approaches, yes.
Have to improvise here. Let's see.
Well, it's not.
So the
I
plan is a rotablator and then is a guy liner. Let's see how
I can tell you of the 25, 26 cases which we have done of the post tower, this
is
will
this
be
the
second
hardest?
Rota case.
Okay.
Yeah, this
no,
is
no,
of
no.
course.
No, we've done
third.
More.
Yeah, no, two. No, one, two, three.
Rota
third,
done.
Yeah, third case of the rota through the with the same situation which we have now, but none of them use the guideliner.
Right? Oh, what's the guideliner?
Because guideliner is the big issue. You need a 7 French. Yeah.
To do rota.
Yeah. Good. Okay. We start here.
Are you there?
Yeah.
That's okay.
Is it? I don't know. If
I
it's
think
it's
almost touching, touching that diamond
aligned.
There.
Yeah. You will be fine.
Yeah.
You will be fine. Yeah.
Okay. Let's do.
Yeah.
Hitting the stent strut. I mean the strut of that.
Okay, then put the guide more on this.
More deeper.
Yeah.
Okay, that's better engaged there.
Yeah, now start now.
Yeah.
You're facing the strut.
Maybe RAO. No.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you see the guide is completely out now. Yep.
Let's see 1 second without that.
So the guide is actually, you know, you see the left main takes at the angle.
Angle, yeah, it's the very, and it's a pretty.
No, it's just that angle, but not the strength.
There
the
you
strut
go.
Of the valve.
Yeah.
You know, I remember from the days we used to do, I used to do a lot of laser angioplasty. The whole key there used to be coaxial.
Coaxiality is the key here.
Yeah, here, because you're not, it's oriented. George, also I have several questions for you once we make a little more headway with this rotational atherectomy.
Well, we can talk if you want while the bearing.
So here, the question here, George, my observation is, you know, from your meta-analysis, which showed about 3 times roughly, I calculated the stent thrombosis long-term. With IDA, it is 4 times. You know, we've noticed that stent thrombosis with BMS and DES was a fairly catastrophic event. How is it that BVS, it is making no impact on the mortality?
Okay, Sam.
Well, first of all, overall, the patient population enrolled in all these trials is low risk. Low risk, single vessel, single lesion, you know that how this situation was in the absorbed trial. So in general, they have some, they can tolerate events. And second, because of the absorbed device and the various warnings, there may be some vigilance around these patients. So they're brought more into medical attention. So I think this is the main reason. This is not a run-of-the-mill classic angioplasty population. This is a lower risk than a much lower risk than average.
On another somewhat related issue, are you surprised at the prolonged growing pains which BVS is experiencing?
Well, I'm surprised. It's just everybody was surprised at this point, and as you know, the investigators of the absorb have announced that they're going to go to from 5 year to 7 or 10 year follow-up.
Yeah.
So essentially what Dr. Sharma was mentioning about the fourth quarter, like every game has, I can tell you the fourth quarter hasn't started. They have already announced that they're looking to win the game in the first or second overtime.
Yeah, but
so this means they themselves predict that it's very difficult to win the game
not limitless resources, no? I mean, and if you take a look at it, you were describing very eloquently, both you and Samin, about the mechanistic issues. But in many ways, why is that a surprise? Why are we surprised 3 or 4 years later that you have to be concerned about some malapposition or some strut hanging out?
Yeah, because I think everybody was once again caught a little bit in the fantasy of the big models that are not a true representation of the atherosclerotic model in humans. And the results were looking a bit too perfect. So if you interpret the results on face value and you don't adjust your expectations by the fact that you will see a different absorption profile in the humans with diseased coronary arteries in comparison to the non-atherosclerotic pig model, then obviously that's what the problem was.
I'm sure one of the difficulties has been, which Dr. Kini also correctly pointed out, you're comparing this with the sophisticated third generation stents.
That doesn't
make it easier either.
But remember, the still having a 3 to 3.5% 1 to 2 year thrombosis rate is that's tough
high.
One. That's high.
That's high.
I mean, you've gone from 0.9 to 3.5%.
Yeah, but remember, these are randomized studies. The population in general is low risk. This means that also the overall stent goes into the low risk. So they have better, better profile. But similarly, it's low risk for the absorb. How do you explain a 3% thrombosis rate in a very low risk population? That shouldn't be. Yeah. And yes, it's tolerated well, but it shouldn't be.
Right. Well, clearly, Samin, you made progress with the rotational.
Yeah, definitely. Meanwhile, the rotablator advanced with the proximal AD very nicely.
Very nicely. and you know, it may indeed be that a moderate path is what may be required today. Samin, a follow-up question on the MACE and ECLIPSE trial. Yeah. So important that you dealt with as a PI of such critical importance, and this experience of what you shared is no way different. I look at the 8 years track record of what we've been doing at CCC Live cases. The approach for heavily and moderately calcified lesions has been exactly lesion modification.
Yeah.
But where I'm a little surprised is it's like a lot of disconnect between either industry or investigators. You have a MACE trial in which there is no use of orbital, and now you have the design of ECLIPSE in which there is no rotablator. Doesn't seem to be getting to the bottom of it.
Yeah, there is a disconnect, and that I can tell you one of the big issue is that what kind of device it is. Once you have a smaller device, an easy device.
Good now.
Yeah.
I mean, clearly, I can tell you one of the findings which you were very intelligent and mature, keeping no conflict of interest whatsoever in your observations. But clearly, one of the lessons coming out of MACE is that for the heavily and the moderately calcified lesion, rotational ablation is the way to go.
No, but question is that a right statement? I don't know.
Well, only the long-term result will show.
Yeah, exactly.
But now, I have no problem with that at all. But once you take a look at ECLIPSE, you've taken out the modality out.
Yes, that is the key.
That didn't make any sense.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's I would say the in all fairness, the investigator or the principal investigator and the study chairman, Greg Stone, it is because they say that we are yet to show long-term benefit of rotational atherectomy even in the calcific lesion, including the rotax strat.
Exactly.
So therefore, we are still onto the same issue.
Well, clearly, much better flow all around.
Yes.
George, sometimes we get surprised by listeners who are listening very carefully to each word. Here is a question directed to you, and I am going to read it exactly as it has been sent. What is the commercial future of BVS in the United States for Dr. Dangus? I don't know why they
chose
you for this.
Commercial future of BVS? Well, that's a commercial answer.
I have no idea.
That is an answer for the Abbott company, and I think as Dr. Sharma already predicted, they will have decisions made after the Absorb 4. At this point, the device is approved in a certain way, and the device has to be used strictly at the FDA label, strictly. And you have to be strictly used of patients with good candidates for distal antiplatelet therapy.
You think the kind of a letter which came to Europe is headed our way too?
That only in the registry?
Yeah, maybe if they have a registry, first of all. I mean, you know, that's the issue is in Europe they have a registry. Over here they don't have a registry. If they make a registry, that would be a good idea. There are concerns about post-approval safety, a surveillance registry would be a good idea.
Right.
But, you know, the use of the PSP technique, the DAPT, and the adherence strictly to FDA label as a very important aspect in the United States.
And I will go a little further. If I am the company person with Abbott, I would say, why do I make a 2.5 absorb?
Right.
No, make. You have to use a 3.0 or bigger
that's
stent.
It.
There's no question.
Abandon making 3.0.
Why,
I mean,
give,
2.5.
Why give a reason to cause more failures?
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. Exactly. Because the way we translate this QCA 2.25, this and that is too much detail. The aspect is that we have
with
to
this and the change.
We have to think that the although support what a 2.5 stent. So what do you need a 2.5 stent? You don't. If you need a 3.0 or above, 3.0, 3.5 or 4.0, this is the usable devices anyhow.
For that subset of the larger vessels, do you think the duration of DAP would be less or it will still be at least 12 months?
Oh, well, until further notice,
we
use a prolonged DAP right now. Right now.
Yeah. So the whole concept originally was that you'll use a less DAP. But it's the final results have been
the other way around. Absolutely other
way around. That's right. We use less DAP and now we end up using more DAP.
Yeah. Meanwhile, I have to point out, if you saw in the angiogram, the flow. The previous angiogram, Dr. Sharma's hypothesis may be already fulfilled. There's a lot of flow in the diagonal, and therefore the flow towards the OM via the jump graft, the portion of the jump graft that's open. The question is that, you know, do we have to achieve a perfect result in the circ? My answer is that no, I don't think so. I think we have to perfect the flow through the diagonal, and I think that all will be done.
Yeah.
And we saw it in the previous view. We have to make sure the guide is good.
Samin, I also made an observation that the new AUC form for most simple lesions, I think it will take less time to do a PCI than to fill the form. There is a A4, there is a B4. It looks like a London highway, London
looks
orbital.
Looks like the tax code, I have to say.
Yeah, IRS.
Particularly today, that's a tax day.
Take it to...
Oh, today's a tax day? What kind of a curve is this?
Okay, now first we have a...
3-5.
Balloon, no, use just simple balloon first. I would say maybe 30 high pressure balloon.
It's some diagonal, range. Doesn't matter. Good, even better.
Right now
have to open the diagonal.
Wrong, some other diagonal.
But we dilate first and then we'll wire, because right now still you'll be in the proximal segment.
What the wire you have now inside
there?
Is a run through, run through.
Long run through.
Which we'll cut soon.
Don't cut it.
Great.
And it's difficult to.
That was a very interesting question that came out of the internet. That is a very, very topical question.
Yeah, lots of people are. George, what are your thoughts on going back to the topic of moderate and severe calcification? What are the respective roles of orbital and rotational atherectomy today? Is there a clean, clear line of delineation, or it's all overlaps?
No, they overlaps quite a bit.
Based
overlaps
on
quite
individual
a bit.
Expertise and experience.
Overlaps quite a bit, exactly as you say. Every lab and every operator have to figure out the preferred technique and stick with that. And that's the more important, to learn the one technique very well as opposed to try to use bits and pieces. Because in the many labs, just setting up atherectomy is a lot of nervousness.
Yeah.
So you have to make sure how you take that nervousness out to make atherectomy more into mainstream. And with a new iteration of the orbital device also, you have a little bit of a better tip, I would say. So you can even advance in areas you might not before. But these are details. For the most part, there's a lot of overlap.
We had a long discussion during the March session, George, on the new AUC criteria. You like them?
I think they're a step further. It's a little complicated because, in all honesty, they try to summarize. There's a lot of medicine that goes in cardiology, unlike that many. That many believe that interventional cardiology and cardiology is a lot of a no-thought plumbing job. You can see how complex these criteria are, and you realize that how much of all of medicine comes into those decisions. And you have to do it. That is the sense in order to properly document the indication of the procedure. And also, I must say, a lot of times is a reminder, is a very good reminder about different options. Just by filling the form, that forces you to think, has the medical therapy truly optimized with multiple drugs and this and that, perhaps in front of a positive nuclear study or something else, this may have been overlooked other times.
To me, the amazing observation is, a few years ago, when you went around the world and watched the progress of PCI there, they used to feel that this AUC is going way beyond. And now you see so much applications, modifications of AUC criteria just about in most places which have high volume PCIs?
Well, what I would like to see is AUC criteria and all other aspects of medicine, and that is one of the big criticisms at the levels of the college and all that, is that this is very good things, and how come cardiology is the only specialty implementing them? And, you know, we should no more be the outliers. Other also have to adhere by similar patient rights or patient, if you want, surveillance methodologies. And I think this is happening. So gastroenterology is coming up, and others following as well.
Yes, I think that those are all positive developments in medicine. The balloons have started floating through that segment where we couldn't even get past.
Very good, very good. It's a full expansion of the balloon.
Yeah, very
with
nice.
With a lot of super expansion of the balloon.
Get a 3.5 angioscope. Yeah, the balloons are rupturing.
They can angio.
George, follow up of patients with the PCI performed through TAVR struts, no way different than routine cases. Dual antiplatelet agents for minimum 12 months?
Well, I think you have to be very active. You don't want to risk recurrences.
So would you convert?
So you have to take that under account.
Would you convert?
You don't want to take lightly those interventions. You want to minimize them. You have to do the best possible job once you start it. And you really have to support it very well with antiplatelet or anti-angina medical therapy afterwards in order to minimize their need for these kinds of procedures. There's no question they are complicated.
No, this guy actually presented initially, he did have a small non-QMI, treated him medically. I did not bring him at that time, saying these patients, you got to make sure three anti-anginal therapy fails.
Yes, absolutely.
Then only they come to the lab.
Have to go an extra mileage for these cases. You have to be absolutely certain.
This is no more, these cases take longer than CTO complex bifurcating left main.
Do you have them on the newer oral antiplatelet agents, or even if they are on clopidogrel, maintain on that?
Because they usually are still
right
on
now.
The clopidogrel, majority of them.
Okay. Majority, or they are in part of the trial.
And then we actually have the Galileo trial, patients who don't have indication for
who do not have atrial fibrillation. Yeah. We're randomizing them to DAPT versus NOVAC.
Samin, I've taken some notes from your MACE trial, and that shows me that 55%
really 55%
of calcified moderate and heavy in the United States is being done with non-compliant balloons.
Yeah, just
like we just did here.
Yeah,
exactly.
With many non-compliant balloons, as you see
here. None. This is a scoring balloon.
And a scoring afterwards. This is again the 3-5-10 angioscope
where
atmosphere.
So you can see how big this vessel has become.
Yeah, absolutely.
Throughout.
Suck the guide in now.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Try
then
to see.
Go to other view.
Yeah, really, what looked to be a 2-5-2-7-5 initial is taking a 3-5 scoring balloon easily. Sure, there is going to be significant improvement in the ischemia and as well as...
No. One thing is for sure that the rotablator went to the side of the CoreValve strut, did not bear the CoreValve strut.
No, when you were talking, remember we went to the cranial view. We wanted to make sure we are in the center of the CoreValve diamond before
we advanced.
Well, I can tell you, 1-5 bird cannot break that strut. This strut is
really hard.
Steel.
Not coming out. Okay. I think we sucked the guide in now.
Yeah. Finally. The end of our case. Why did it not suck in earlier? We wanted this to happen earlier. Let's suck it in once more.
Now let's get the stent in.
We have a 3538 here.
Good, right?
Okay. Yeah, we'll take one picture and then take
the stent. Careful. Damping. Oh,
looks wonderful.
Beautiful.
The
you
flow
can
there
that.
Is.
So remember, I kept on saying that now the diagonal filling that OM.
Yes.
See that one?
Yes.
So the diagonal filling the OM.
You have to make sure the stent finishes before the diagonal, though.
Yeah. Exactly.
No,
I wonder if 38 is too long.
And other thing, we have to make sure Lima will stay open.
Yeah, Lima will
stay.
After
we did all this.
Oh, Lima is fine.
Now it has matured.
Yeah, you can see in the top right of this film, you can see the jump graft portion from diagonal going down towards OM.
And that is why
see
I
better
wanted
in
to
the
show that angiogram. Yeah.
Well, to go to a
old angiogram.
No, no, here we took a, see here.
You'll see it later.
Picture. Here, here.
Well, just the augmented
so
flow
we have
has
to make
changed
sure we are below, before the diagonal.
Yeah,
okay. Maybe before the diagonal. That view was good? The, or you want to take this view?
No, this view.
This view.
It'll be epicranial, yeah.
No, this is aleocranial.
Yeah.
Samir, you see this view we took?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So our goal is that from the left main
look
to the
entire
deep
entire flow dynamics has totally improved. It's just what's your stent strategy here?
What 3538 we are going.
Okay.
And then in this view we'll place it before the diag where there's a bypass. Okay.
Great.
Good. Go.
But which diag has a bypass?
But the big one.
This one.
You right. Better avoid all of them. D3. Don't jail any of them.
Yeah.
But 38 may jail them. No?
Yeah, 38.
Well, that's why I'm wondering about that. We'll find out. Yeah. If we need B, we'll take it out.
No, but which diag actually has a graft?
Okay.
It's so not clear in this one.
The
one we are seeing is the
problem
OM.
Is that the graft comes exactly where the pacemaker is. We'll take another view.
Yeah.
No other view is showing it to us. Yeah. See?
No, we'll take another picture. That's what I'm saying. It's in the high diagonal, it's not the low, the third diagonal.
It's the high diagonal, Because later on then
I
comes the OM.
38 will be, well, we'll see.
38 I think will cover it.
Let's see, well, we have a 33 as well, if we need to be, a 32.
I have a 32 ready.
Barman,
I have a 32.
Looks okay, I guess.
To bring it up, bring it out.
No, no, I know. If I allow to take out the guide now, before that, let's confirm.
Yeah.
Are we in the right spot?
What is happening on the side? Yeah. Any cases? Okay. Yeah. Call him. Yeah. Okay. Good. Sine? Yeah. Call him. Pull back. Yeah.
Well, it's not covered the diagonal there.
Yeah.
You're just
good.
About
we
okay.
We can pull back. Now cover the ostium. We are okay.
I think we are doing good.
Yeah.
I'm going to pull out the guide now,
right.
George. After this, we can't
yeah,
go
yeah.
in
pull
again.
Pull the stand and pull the guide.
Okay.
Or pull the guide and pull the stand. That's good. Put the stand right next to the CoreValve. That's good.
Uh-oh.
So next time we know, we have to find the mouth of the of the stand. That would help.
Okay,
the
ready.
Stand sticking out in this situation will help.
Good. No?
Yeah, let's take it
I
here.
Think so. No?
All right.
This is the only view,
it's
though.
It's 3.5,
no?
A
lot of it sticking out. You know that. This
is
not normally that we do. I know we are placing it in the mouth of the...
3.5, 3.8.
We need a 4.0 or a 4.5 to really... See this?
Post-expand,
a lot sticking out. Normally we don't do like this. What do you think?
Yeah, it's quite a bit of sticking out. Yeah, the way best we saw, just AP. Yeah, see it now. See? The question
I think we have to go 32.
No, no, you can go still few millimeter inside.
No.
Enough room.
Yes, sir.
Actually, you may be okay here. Take a sine. You're okay.
No, you still have at least 10 millimeter sticking out.
Where?
Not 10, it's not 10. It's
look
probably
at the
5.
Left main stops here. This is 10 millimeter sticking out.
Okay, so 2 millimeter you still can go.
No. Go, you saw the picture here. How can you go 2 millimeters in? That's the
you can
that's
go 2 millimeters in.
You can go 2 millimeter, yeah. 2 millimeter, go. That will be okay. Don't take it out now. Go just 2 millimeter here and we'll be okay.
I'm just telling you, it's still sticking out.
Okay, good.
Okay, going up now.
You don't want to stick out like that much?
Yeah, it's okay. It's not sticking out too much. Okay.
Ready?
Okay, go.
Fire, as we say.
Yeah.
The expansion was very nice.
16.
Yeah.
I don't think it's sticking out too
expanded.
Much.
And use the same balloon as I was still flat.
It's a good
statement.
Write it down.
4 or 5.
Good statement. Write it down.
Osteal flash.
We use the same balloon as osteal flash.
Yeah, pull back a little bit.
What is the meaning of that?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
A little bit more. Yeah, that's good. That's a true austere flush now.
Yeah, that's it.
Go crazy now, 20 atmospheres.
Yep. Crazy stuff.
Yeah, crazy, no, 22.
Keep fluoro.
Okay.
Yeah, fluoro.
I don't know. Just make sure the valve doesn't come out.
Yeah, the valve will come out. Wow, boom.
Yes.
Okay, that's great.
Don't do all the funny things.
Okay, let's see.
Now bring the guide on this balloon and then we'll see. So we need to end
now
our
try to suck the guide in
everything
now.
Is good. Yeah.
Make sure there's no restenosis, please.
Oh, God.
Go.
There's no restenosis or thrombosis here. Let's make sure we see the collateral to the arm this way.
Wonderful.
Yeah, yeah, it's coming. You see that in the end?
Yes, yes.
It's coming via,
the
you
jump
know,
draft.
Via the third stop.
We're done.
I think we're done here. We'll get 4, 5, 15, forget everything. Wire out.
Ready? No. I don't. For us to get a picture.
Leave the wire if you want to be, but balloon out.
You want to go in lower mag? Panoramic view. We'll do a panoramic view for the audience.
I mean, considering how aggressive his coronary artery disease has progressed, and I know there is elevated creatinine. Before sending him out, you want to take one picture of the graft to the RCA, or that's no needed?
Yeah, that's a picture of the graft. Yeah. You saw it now.
No, one reason is because there was no ischemia at all in the inferior
territory.
Wall.
Yeah, okay, all right.
The all lateral and inferolateral signifying the circumflex, because we have a good stress system maybe on him.
So, excellent four-man PCI, including three of
this
you and the
great.
Fellow.
This is great.
Wire out now.
You can take wire out and immediately as he injects.
Okay.
Go.
You see, it's not sticking out too much. You can see that.
Yeah.
And the diagonal is good for where it comes out of the graft. You see that graft jumping there?
Absolutely.
It's from the third diagonal. Second diagonal, really. There's a third and a... Now we can see that very clearly where it comes out.
Do you want to open the ostium a little more with a bigger balloon?
We're all good.
Okay, good. Okay, with that note, I think we just come to our slide presentation and sum up today's marathon case. This is the take-home message of the MACE and the ABSORB, the first prospective registry of PCI outcome based on the lesion calcium. That's the MACE study, showed lower procedural success and higher follow-up MACE rates in lesions with severe calcium, but not with a moderate or mild calcium. Hence, future ablation strategy and plaque modification devices should focus on improving outcomes of these severely calcified lesions. Second, ABSORB BVS continues to perform poorly compared to Zines DES, largely due to late scaphold thrombosis and higher TLF rate. Majority of these adverse results stem from use of ABSORB in smaller vessels, less than 2.5 size on angio, and hence its use in small vessels should be avoided. Optimal BVS implantation technique have promised to reduce the late cardiac events as they have shown, and hopefully ABSORB 4 will answer that. So quickly, three questions. Following statements are true regarding the one-year outcomes of the MACE study, except outcomes are dependent on the degree of lesion calcification. Severely and moderately calcified lesions have similar worse outcome compared to mild calcium. Then severely calcific lesions have higher dissection versus less severe calcium. Severely calcific lesions have similar slow flow as less severe calcium. And lastly, severely calcified lesions have higher mortality at follow-up versus mild to moderate calcified lesions. So which one is false, you need to check that. Second, in the MACE trial, rotational atherectomy was used in this percent of heavily calcified lesions in the heavily calcified group of that 102 patients. Less than 10, 11 to 25, 26 to 40, 41 to 50, and more than 50% should be clear. The third is, the ABSORB 3 trial results at 2 years showed the following outcomes, except higher thrombosis with BVS, higher MI rate with BVS, higher TLF rates with BVS, higher TVR rates with BVS, and lastly, the higher death rates with BVS compared to Zines DES. So all those questions, answers are available on our website. And with that, we just conclude our this morning very unusual presentation. But I'm glad that things have, we were able to talk. Lot of new techniques and how to, this emerging problem which we'll be facing more and more with the TAVR patients coming to the cath lab for subsequent event
coronary related event not related to their original valve.
Samin, excellent review. I think a beautiful case is so much for operators to learn. I think what you mentioned in the very early part of your discussion about most of the PCI issues should be handled prior to placing a TAVR. I think that is lesson number one. And of course, some of the teaching tips, I hope the viewers have found it useful. George, thank you so much for joining us. Anu, great skills. Congratulations again for the award. And we'll see you all on session number 95 on May the 16th.
Session number 95, we'll look forward to it.
Yeah. Great, Samir.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.